Hi. My name is Simona Panaitescu. I'm Romanian. And I want to speak today about the teaching called the New Revelation, which dates from the 19th century and was given to two laymen called Jakob, Lorber and Gottfried, Mayerhofer. This is a teaching that I discovered 16 years ago, and sincerely, because it's a very vast amount of books, you know, and information, I was thought I am unable to speak about this, and I'm not the person to support such a cause, because this is really, to me, the most important thing in the world, because it is a teaching that is written in the first person with the author Jesus Christ. And when I started to read the main work, which is an 11 volumes book called The Great Gospel of John, I didn't believe that. I didn't believe that this was, you know, the real word of Jesus. So when it struck me that this is true, and I spoke somewhere else about how it happened, and I realized that this is simply the most important thing possible, the Word of God. And from then on, my drive was to find somebody else to speak about this. I don't know, a nice Christian, somebody who's very knowledgeable in matters of religion and Christianity and the Bible and everything, to connect the dots and speak about this. And I couldn't find it, so this is very sad, because I have to do it. So now you ask me anything you want to ask me, because there's so many things to say.
Yeah.
But I think this is the high time to speak about this, because this new revelation has got predictions and prophecies concerning the end times, meaning the period right before the second coming of the Lord. And this should happen, it is, you know, stated repeatedly, before 2,000 years from the death of on the cross of the Lord will occur. The idea is that would be around the year 2029, and we see all these strange events unfolding, especially, you know, cataclysms like storms or very dangerous wildfires, or we see epidemics and on a large scale, and all these things have been predicted. I can read the words, but the idea is that this is a period of huge trials for humanity, and as it was in the time of Noah, the Lord is of course active and is speaking through his people and tries to warn the existing humanity about, you know, the collapse that is coming, and shows them the right way to save themselves physically and spiritually. So my whole intervention is about this, what it should be the most important thing right now, in order for people to have the divine support they need, because whoever is aware of what is happening and of all the dangers we are facing may quite easily realize that there's not much human power that can change the situation, and that we need so much more, you know, to stop the extinction of species, of humanity, the damages that we inflicted upon nature, you know. And of course the Creator can do this. The Creator promised us that he will save us. You know, it is in the Bible in 2 Chronicles 7:14, that if we will repent and turn from our wicked ways and seek the face of God, He will come and save the and heal the land, you know.
Could you tell us, why would the New Revelation be a credible teaching coming from God for most people who haven't read any of it at all? What's your view there?
You know, I'm not here to sell something. So yeah. It's not up to me to, you know, show people, you know, the new trend in matter of religion or anything. To me, this is the Word of God. I mean, it has nothing to do with myself. I have no merit, you know, in finding this or in speaking now about this. I consider myself 100% unworthy to speak about the Word of an infinite, extraordinary, wonderful, overwhelming God. I'm not the person to do it, but I will do it because I couldn't find anybody else. So I don't want to convince people that this is credible. The only thing I would like people to be convinced is that I would die for this. I would, you know, it. To me, this is the ultimate truth. So if this is not truth, nothing else is, you know, nothing else matters. Simply, my life doesn't matter. Everything that is good and noble and worthy to admire has absolutely no meaning, and existence is absurd. And I put this in balance, you know, with the awareness of a God who is infinite love, and, you know, who proceeded to this creation out of this incredible love, you know, and gives this amazing purpose of forever evolving in love and wisdom. So if I put in a balance this with the utter absurdity of any existence, you know, we arrive here by accident and we disappear, you know, without any trace, I cannot have but this choice. But, you know, it's even more than that. It's with any true conversion to a faith is not a matter of mind. The mind gives you this idea, you know, that things should be credible and reasonable and rational. But this is a matter of heart. This is exactly as it happens to somebody when that person falls in love. When you fall in love, you know. You have this awareness that, you know, this is love. It may have never happened to you before, but then you know that there's no other word or concept to describe, you know. And this is, you know, the faith is truly, I mean, this true faith for me in the true God, who is love, is in fact equivalent with falling in love with Him. Nothing else. And once you fall in love with love, with this eternal love, which is God, you know, this is the ultimate truth.
Yeah.
It cannot be otherwise. So this is what you find in the New Revelation, this God. I mean, nobody, to my knowledge, nobody ever expressed in the known literature a higher degree of love and compassion and mercy and generosity as this God that you can find, this God who is Jesus Himself that you can find in the New Revelation. More than that, this Jesus from the New Revelation is not like another New Age type of Jesus, you know, that we have seen again and again in new so-called new communications from God, you know. It's the very same Jesus that you can find in the Bible. I mean, in this central work of the New Revelation, the Great Gospel of John, you have a Jesus who performed everything that you can find in the Gospels. And, you know, the same miracles, the same fundamental sentences, who, you know, did all the works and finally was sentenced and tortured and crucified, and then after 3 days came back to a visible manifestation and show himself to his disciples and taught them. And then you have absolutely all you can find in the Bible. So is this so-called Christian, if you can say, you know, a Christian Jesus or a Christian God, is nothing else. But imagine that what you have in the Bible is expanded on 7,000 pages. So there's so much beyond you, what you find in the Bible. And this, of course, corresponds with common sense, and also with what you find in the last words of John, from the great from the Gospel of John in the Scripture, meaning that, you know, if everything that the Lord did would be put in writing, all the books in this world will not be enough to contain that. So this is to give a sign, you know, to all disciples that they should stay open, you know, for the Word of God. And then another thing that I believe may be hidden behind your question is, why would Christian find such a teaching credible? But it's very simple. The answer is, again, in their own Bible, because it is written, you know, by Paul, that you have to test everything and keep what is good. You do not have to quench the Spirit. You know, in the first Christian churches, which is nothing else than gatherings of followers of Christ, they had, you know, the first rank, so to say, in the church was that of the prophets. So they continued to have prophets after Jesus, you know, and although they have apostles, they also have these people who received messages from God. So this you can find again and again in the letters of the apostles, that, you know, they should come with this gift of prophecy. They should, you know, share with the believers. So I don't know if this is an answer to your question, but the main issue that this teaching, you know, poses to everybody is, you know, who gave it to us? It was simply Lorber who wrote it down, and later on another fellow, you know, called Gottfried Mayerhofer, who wrote a smaller amount of books. So it was them, or it was the one who presents himself as the real author. Because if it was them, they were lying, because they were pretending to be Jesus and God. So we have two liars who bring over, to me, the most majestic literature and, you know, image of God ever that you can find in the in all human literature. So this is a product of two liars. Maybe you can find this, you know, conceivable, but I don't think so. Moreover, the Jew confirmed the Bible, you know. They do come with such amazing prophecies concerning the end time, you know, and it's still, you know, rubbish. They come with scientific predictions, you know, like, you know, the fact that in this universe there are countless galaxies, that there are systems upon systems of suns of galaxies and so on, that, you know, astronomy didn't even imagine, like, 100 years ago, not to mention at the time of, you know, when these things were written by Lorber and Mayerhofer.
So what you're saying is that the scribes noted down from a divine voice, which they heard in the region of their heart.
Yeah, so it
lots
is
of things that science had yet to prove.
Had yet to prove.
As
decades
time unfolded,
and centuries afterwards.
Many decades, even centuries later, things have been discovered. The thing that fascinates me is, if you could answer that question, is all the different environmental things are all coming together now, especially the phrase, was it malicious diseases?
Yeah, this is one of the main predictions.
Yeah.
So I can even read a couple of quotes on this, because the main idea is that before the second coming, the Lord speaks, according to my faith, you know, the Lord speaks in this word about, you know, so-called judgments of purification for humanity. And this includes natural upheavals like storms and earthquakes and, you know, very, very damaging fires, you know, on, that will destroy, that will raise to the ground whole regions and big cities and so on. Plus, what you said, malicious epidemics, which sounded very weird to me when I read that first time, because I didn't understand why they should be malicious. But now, after all I read lately, it makes a bit of sense, because some epidemics can be created by humans today, you know, through bioengineering. We call these bioweapons. So all kinds of viruses and stuff is what we are seeing today, could have been made in a lab, you know. But I'll rather read to you a couple of things that we can find in the New Revelation. So I want you to know that these are to be found in the Great Gospel of John. So according to the testimony of the New Revelation, these are messages that Jesus gave to his disciples 2,000 years ago. We cannot, you know, speaking about social justice and about, you know, true love between people and about being as brothers and sisters, we cannot be that unless we have a common Father. And that Father would be a loving one who would teach us to love each other. You see, each one of us has these experiences in life which were set up for us, you know, as children and then brothers and sisters and then parents ourselves. So we learn all these roles. Why do we do that? Because through all these means, we can understand the love of God and we can love God. So I will just read to you, this is to me, the most wonderful thing I've ever read in my life. And the thing that I love most in the whole New Revelation, although I love everything, but it says, "For," and that's the Lord speaking, "For the sake of one child, I shall sacrifice thousands of millions of suns and worlds of all kinds, if I could not otherwise have it come back to me. If, however, it were a question of a child only being saved by my giving this my only eternal life for it, I would rather let these two go from me than lose one of my children." Can you comprehend such love? You know, and the main subject, I think it was about the predictions, about the trials that we have to endure in these times, and about the love, which is the way out. There's no other way but love. And what you find this in here is not only the philosophy, it's the promise. It's like, you know, with Noah and the ark, and you said before, the ark of love. Yeah. Love is the promise that we will get rid of these issues, even though we may not be in the physical body anymore. But, yeah, we will be in the order of God. We will be beneficiary of his extraordinary mercy and grace. We will be happy. He will wipe all the tears from our eyes.